Welcome to Gateway. This is an extra. I promised that I would read the notebook, Rolf's notebook, so we're gonna do that. This is fairly long, and most of you will probably want to tune it out, but this lays down the specifics of the world that Rolf is on by telling you the creatures that he encounters, some of the plants that he's encountered, and how he has come to appreciate those things. So the way that Rolf deals with things will become apparent once you see all the data that he's collected and how he handles situations with these animals. And this is why we're trying to please Rolf, because we're trying to do things his way. So without further ado, read notebook. You open the field notebook and read the first entry. Date, February 21, 2088. Also notice that this is a fair amount of time ago, but we've established it already. Subject, S. Cantaloupe Humunga. Observed a four-legged animal that strongly resembles a horse grazing in a grassy area on top of the mountain plateau. It saw me and ran away, but was back in a few hours. I found a good place to hide and observe him. I named him S. Cantaloupe Humunga because they canter like horses and are really big. You turn it to the next entry on page 2 of Becker's field notebook. Date, March 3, 2088. Phalangomorph Mandibula. I've been sighting these things on the plateau since I landed. They range from about, they're about 10 to 20 centimeters in length and are about 7 centimeters wide. There are thousands of them. They're invertebrates of some kind, but have many of the traits of amphibians. Their bite is poisonous and hurts like hell. I've been bitten a few times, and the wounds take weeks to heal, which is why I've named them Phalangomorph Mandibula. Their pincers are about 10 times larger than their abdomen. They are nearly impossible to catch, making them difficult to study. The next several pages contain a comparative analysis of the migratory behavior of Geranthemis swooper, who stopped flipping pages in an interesting entry on page 18. Date, July 9, 2088. S. Geranthemis swooper. Since my arrival, I've had to deal with a huge variety of birds that is quite prevalent. They strongly resemble pterodactyl species from Earth textbooks I read as a child. The indigenous species here are much smaller, though, and extremely intelligent. I learned quite by accident that various high-pitched tones elicit specific and often strange reactions in them, perhaps relating to migratory or mating behaviors. After experimenting with a few handmade whistles, I was able to make one that causes them to sleep, another that causes them to attack, and yet another that seems to pacify them. A few months after I arrived, one aggressive one of these birds made a nest beside the wreckage of my ship and wouldn't let me get near it. I eventually was able to find the correct frequency and a whistle to drive it away. Another one built a nest in the pinnacles outside my house, and yet another whistle was required to appease it. The whistles don't seem to have the same effect on each animal. Very strange indeed. Anyway, I think the one outside my house likes me. It's been there for a long time and has periodically protected me from cantaloupes that have wandered into the cliffs. It swoops down from its perch and bars the way across my oak bridge, but it just lets me pass right by. I've sighted 24 different subspecies of S. Geranthemis swoop in the vicinity of my home. Some are aggressive, but most of them make themselves guess when they see me coming. And we've actually encountered this particular swoop. You turn to the next entry on page 19 of Becker's field notebook. Date, February 15, 2089, so that's like about a year later. S. Geraldo Cassius. An aggressive species of cactus occurs sparsely throughout the desert terrain of this planet. Standing over 4 meters tall, an adult S. Geraldo Cassius possesses limbs of unimaginable destructive power, clearly as an evolved defense mechanism. These organisms are able to propel their massive limbs at will to the detriment of the casual observer. The slightest pressure on the surface of one of the spine-covered limbs causes the plant to swing its limbs wildly in the direction of the unwary victim. I was lucky enough to learn of these plants' behavior by watching one impale a helpless injured jackalope. I happened to brush one of its arms. needles from the armor of the Estrualdo quickly skewered the animal, causing immediate death. Thank God these plants do not possess mobility, or the desert terrain would be dominated by huge green barbed aggressors, intent on making concussions out of all the creatures they encountered. Although fierce and deadly, the plants do not seem to possess any reasoning ability, and I've often amused myself by throwing things at them from a safe distance. Their arms wave violently in all directions for a moment, and soon resume their seemingly harmless frozen pose. The next several pages contain a study of feeding patterns of desert invertebrates. You stop flipping pages and interesting entry on page 28. Date, August 13, 2090. Again, another year has passed. S. Rodenta Roadrunner. The fastest organism to inhabit this planet appears to be in the ubiquitous S. Rodenta Roadrunner. Sprinting at speeds exceeding 100 kilometers an hour, they are nearly impossible to catch. I've been marginally successful at capturing a few injured specimens for further study, although I always release them when done with my observations. And again, here we're learning that he doesn't like killing things. They run from 23 to 40 centimeters in length and resemble miniature prairie dogs. Their incredible speed seems to be the result of specialized leg muscles and aerodynamic body shape. They're warm-blooded and seem to bear their children live. Their metabolism resembles that of earth rodents, their hearts beating over 300 times per minute. Perhaps resulting from their extremely short nights on this planet, they seem to require little or no sleep. Analysis of their fecal deposits, But anyway, it's giving him data, has led me to conclude that they subsist largely on a diet of leafy plants and small insects, of which there are hundreds of species in local habitat. They build subterranean tunnels just below the surface of the desert, in which they rest and rear their young. It is quite amusing to see a tunnel being dug, a slight furrow rising from the desert, as it winds out of sight. It is not at all uncommon to see a group of S. Rodenta racing at top speed across the desert terrain. Although disconcerting at first, I have grown fond of their playful games, racing to and fro amid the fragile ecosystem of my adopted home. The next several pages contain analysis of the chemical composition of Geranthemis droppings. You stop flipping the pages, an interesting entry on page 34. Again, a year has passed. This is December 24, 2091. Escherichia robustus. Certainly the oddest of intelligent organisms on this planet is Escherichia robustus, similar in appearance to Earth's dinosaurs, but extremely small, standing less than a foot tall. Escherichia are adept at negotiating the craggy cliff tops of the local terrain, living like big horned sheep. They roam courageously atop the rocky mountain tops, building nests and eating flora that only occur naturally at extreme elevations. Escherichia, like S. Rodenta Roadrunner, are extremely mobile, enabling them to evade their natural predators, which are, at this time, unknown to me. They possess an extremely small horn embedded in their head, which serves as a powerful deterrent to the unwary aggressor. They communicate with each other through a system of barking and whining that can be quite noisy and annoying. When happy, the Gopheria is a quiet and peaceful species, desiring lots of food and sleep but little else. Escherichia seem to be extremely social, living in groups of 2 to 7. I encountered a member of a Gopheria clan on a recent hike to the mountains, surrounding the mountain plateau where I live. It seemed to be stranded on a particularly jagged clifftop, and its friends or family had abandoned it. Risking my own life, I did manage to free the small creature, and it immediately befriended me. Again, we're seeing his character here. He didn't just want to abandon the thing to die. Befriended me, following close behind my heels all the way back to my house. It insisted on sleeping on my mattress until I fashioned one especially for it. It seems it content to lounge around my home day in and out, leaving only occasionally to hunt for the mysterious plants it needs to survive. And this is his Gopheria that we've seen before. As pets go, Gopheria is certainly one of the gentlest and most rewarding animals a human could befriend, attentive and empathetic, and requiring little other than a soft bed. The next several pages contain observations of the mating rituals of Gopheria robustus. You stop flipping pages at an interesting entry on page 47. Again, another year has passed. Est jubifrutus deliciosa. Tracking my adopted escropharia, I was able to finally determine the exact species of plant it requires for subsistence. Est jubifrutus deliciosa is a quite delicious and sweet leafy plant that occurs naturally at extreme elevations in the mountains surrounding my clufftop home. The leaves of S. jubifrutus give off a pungent and sweet aroma, and Escopharia seems to eat twice its weight in them every few days. And again, this we need to know, because in order to befriend his Gopharia, we need to know what it eats. You turn to the next entry on page 48 of Becker's field notebook. 2 years have passed. Date January 2, 1994. S. winopelia avia. Napping in a nearby meadow, I came across the strangest of trees I've seen so far. These trees, which I've named S. winopella avia, yeah, I think I mangled that the first time around, produce seeds which occasionally take flight like small helicopters, spinning around a few feet in the air. They then settle back toward the ground. Perhaps this behavior is a defense mechanism, protecting them from predators. Perhaps the seeds reorient themselves to areas where the soil conditions are better. These questions remained unanswered. As far as I've been able to determine, the one S. winopella avia I've found is the only one on this entire plateau. It may be the last of its kind, and I treat it with special care, watering it occasionally during times of drought. Again, we're finding that he's kind and considerate of all the beasts and the flowers and so on that he encounters. The next several pages contain recordings of average ground speeds of Rodenta Roadrunner. You stop flipping pages and interesting entry on page 78. This is October 5, 2097, 3 years later. S. Mendoburnum violetta. This strange bush resembles a creosote, but possesses leaves shaped like fly swatters that attack small insects hovering beside them. Apparently not carnivorous, the reason for this is evolved behavior is unclear. It is, however, quite amusing to watch. You turn to the next entry on page 79 of Becker's Field Notebook. It's 2098, May 2, in fact. S. peruvocalis. I first observed S. peruvocalis early this year, hunting for a dentist scurrying across on the desert floor. It's also interesting to me, and I hope you don't mind me breaking the reading here just to point this out, that he has been on the planet at this point for nearly 9 years, and he keeps on discovering new things about it. It's interesting because he doesn't actually see the whole ecosystem up front, like you'd imagine happening on Earth. The ecosystem reveals itself to him slowly over time as he studies it. They resemble parakeets and make an awful racket, screeching and squawking constantly. They're extremely timid and avoid all contact with me, with one very strange exception. So this is probably how he hasn't noticed them before. I discovered this quite by accident when I was experimenting with some drums I manufactured to enhance my life here with the joys of music. One day, while I was experimenting with abstract meterless rhythms, a paru landed less than a meter away from me and began squawking like crazy. The moment I stopped playing, he flew away, but immediately returned when I resumed my playing. I'm not sure this is a trait shared by all S. peru, but whenever I start playing, one of them soon appears and lands on the stand, squawking along with me until I'm done. Perhaps S. peru vocalis possesses an innate attraction to certain percussive rhythms and is drawn to rhythmic sources against its will. More study is required of this strange bird. You've already read the entire notebook. Do you want to start at the beginning again? No. And that is it for this episode. Thank you so much for watching. In the next episode, we will get right back to playing the actual game. But I felt that it was important that you guys see and experience the notebook as it's meant to be experienced in the game, because this is all important information for how to deal with Becker, important information for how to deal with the flora and fauna on the actual planet, and important information for, you know, just backstory things that games don't really do anymore. So there you go. Thank you so much for watching. I will see you soon. Have a great week. And when we meet up again in Gateway, I look forward to meeting us up again in Gateway. Goodbye, folks.